now in the name of Jesus, now in the name of Jesus, every yoke is broken now in the name of Jesus. Oh, now in the name of Jesus, oh, now in the name of Jesus, liberty to every captive. Oh, now in the name of Jesus, oh, now in the name of Jesus, every prison door is open. Oh, now in the name of Jesus, oh, now in the name of Jesus, every yoke, it is broken. Oh, now in the name of Jesus, oh, now in the name of Jesus, every prison door is open. Oh, now in the name of Jesus, oh, now in the name of Jesus, a mighty moving of your Spirit, Lord. Oh, now in the name of Jesus, oh, now in the name of Jesus, every mind-blinding spirit removed. Oh, now in the name of Jesus, oh, now in the name of Jesus, every yoke, it is broken. Oh, now in the name of Jesus, oh, now in the name of Jesus, revive your work in our midst. Oh, now in the name of Jesus, oh, now in the name of Jesus, all the floodgates are open. Oh, now in the name of Jesus, oh, now in the name of Jesus, the floodgates are open. Oh, now in the name of Jesus, oh, now in the name of Jesus, a great moving of your Spirit, Lord. Oh, now in the name of Jesus, oh, now in the name of Jesus, every mind-blinding spirit removed. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. Father, we pray right now as souls are weighed in the balance, oh God, and so many people have been so far removed from the reality of who you are. Father, we pray right now in the name of Jesus that the work of the Holy Ghost will once again rise with great fire and with great outpouring by your glorious love and grace. Father, we pray, oh God, in Jesus' name, that you would revive your work again in the midst of us, oh Lord. Father, that once again a great and glorious church would stand up in the midst of the earth. Father, we pray that the hard hearts would be softened, oh God. Father, those things, oh Lord, that have hidden away your glory, Father God, that they would be removed in Jesus' mighty name. Conserve chi te ne marromova, chi serve se tu lo mondaia, che serve chi te lo bomba preme mea sotto gli avrai, chi serve se te la vena, chi serve per mamma mando, ma malandese, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Lord in heaven to me. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. The one who set me free. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. You're both Lord in heaven to me. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Jesus.
I surrender all to you. I surrender all to you. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Come be glorified. Come be glorified in me. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I surrender all to you. I surrender all to you. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Both Lord in heaven. Both Lord in heaven to me. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I surrender all to you. Be glorified. Be glorified. Let there be a people who glorify you. Be magnified, be magnified. Raise up a people that will magnify you. Oh, be glorified, be glorified. Raise up a people that will glorify you. Be magnified, be magnified. Raise up a magnify you, Jesus, 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 both Lord in heaven to me. Oh, Jesus, 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 I surrender all to you. Oh, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, be glorified. Be glorified in me. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Be revealed in the midst of your church. Jesus Christ. Jesus, my Christ. Lord and Messiah, Jesus, Jesus, both Lord and heaven to me.
We thank you. Hallelujah.
And among this, again, and among this, again. My mama, Ben, and she came. Will everybody just give a shout of thanksgiving to the Lord? Hallelujah. Lord Jesus, we worship you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, we worship you. You know, people have drifted so far from seeking the Lord that they don't even know how to go to church anymore on a regular basis. But during the times of revival and during the times of the move of God, there's always a people that are mobilized that begin to find a place, a hidden away in God and hidden away in the things of heaven. They begin to lay hold on God 7 days a week. There's a great cry that begins to come forth from the heart of pleading, a hunger, a desperation for the things that Father revealed in His Word and that Jesus Christ made known to us by His life. The things that the power of the Holy Ghost brought to the church when Father sent the promise and the glory of heaven came to rest here in the realms of men. For the first time since the sin and iniquity of Adam began about 1971 years ago. And many people have drifted. They've drifted so far they don't even know anymore. They just assume that they can carouse with the world and that they can choose the life that they want to live. But the reality of it is they've only come partway with God. They may have been born again to some degree. You know, it's like maybe it's like they got crucified with Christ, but they never got buried. And so self has a stench that is beyond all comprehension. It's time to get buried so that you can be risen up and you be raised up with Him. Hallelujah. I mean, the Barasatana Mangekala Mashika Yanahada Ishaprata. to be raised up with them. Hallelujah. To be raised up with them, really, and to ascend up with him into a glorious realm, to now live with him, because there's no really living with him until you be willing to take your place in the heavenly realm. And I'm going to tell you right now, there's a clear distinction between the people of God who have become heavenly and the people who are still are wavering and halting between two opinions. They still don't know that the more of their life is spent in doing their own will than the will of the Father, pursuing their own interest than the heavenly ones. And no matter what we try to tell them, and no matter what we try to describe to them, still they don't get it. Once again, that they in the midst of the building, they're captivated by the anointing. They hear it and they respond, but it doesn't go in deep. And so just like it was in the former days, during the days of Isaiah, during the days of Jeremiah and Ezekiel, when God's pleading with his people, they listened to the prophet as one who played an instrument well and had a very melodious voice, captivated by what was saying, but they never were willing to do it. They were never willing to follow through. People, you better watch out. The world can still have more of you than what you realize. It's manifested by the fruits of your life and by the decisions that you make. We pray that every one of you be captivated by the beauty of Christ Jesus and begin to take up your cross and follow him and deny yourself and recognize that Father paid a high price for you and I to be citizens of heaven and not citizens of this world. God paid a high price for you and I to have his most precious gift so that we could walk out his will by his divine power rather than living our own will and doing our own thing. And people, I'm going to tell you right now, one of the chief things that God says is do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is, but assemble yourself all the more as you see the day approaching. And I see the day approaching, 1971 years, even if you can't see the day because you're spiritually blind, at least you could calculate numbers and say, my goodness, we're a whole lot closer now than we were then. And they said it then, about 1960 or 19, at most 1950 years ago, that verse of scripture was written. These are perilous times, and I'm just so blessed that you are here tonight. And I pray that you allow God to birth within your heart the thing that is going on in the heart of Jesus Christ right now. Whoever lives to make intercession for the saints, because there's not a lot of people that are moved with that level of compassion, that are moved with that level of being united with the heart of God. Many people, once again, are captivated doing their own will. We've got to understand that we are in troublous times. We've got to grab a hold of the things that the Holy Ghost has provided for us and recognize that they are not just an option. They are necessary. They are essential. If we're going to have what they had in the days of Charles Finney, when Father Nash was around, we're going to have to understand the same kind of prayer that they gave themselves to. If we're going to have the move of God that took place in India under the leadership of Praying Hyde, we're going to have to understand the consecration. Someday, somehow, we're going to have to come back to sanctification and understand that we've been baptized in the glorious life of Jesus and baptized in the various glorious fire of the Holy Ghost to live completely and totally separated unto the purpose and to the will of God. We are up against it, people. We are up against spiritual wickedness that you cannot even begin to imagine. You listen to me. The one insight I had in raising my children was I realized I was up against spiritual wickedness that I was no match for, and I prayed and cried out to God every day, oh God, intervene on my behalf, oh Lord, protect us, because I can see the enemy and he's at our gate. And Father, in his love, if we just walk it out, if we walk it out in obedience, if we walk it out in consecration, what we're going to do is we're going to find ourselves being a part of what Father just suddenly did in the midst of Evan Roberts' life, in the midst of John Hyde's life. And I can go on with so many people who just said, Lord, I'm not going to live my own life anymore. I recognize I belong to heaven. And you know, I mean, John Hyde was so radical. He said, I would rather burn out than rust out. And he basically died getting no sleep. He didn't sleep. He just had prayer vigils all night. But millions of souls came into the kingdom. He just was up with God all night, up with Christ Jesus, up all night with Christ Jesus. The doctors examined his heart and said, there's something seriously wrong with you. What have you been doing? When they asked him, he just smiled. He said, your heart has moved over out of its spot from where it's supposed to be on the left side, and it's moved over more to the right, within the cavity of the heart. What have you been doing? This only happens. This is a rare case. It only happens in the instance of extreme stress. What have you been doing? Burying the souls of a nation? But he didn't tell him that. You guys can be seated. I tell you, I'm fully loaded here tonight with something so radical, so urgent from heaven. I'm here tonight to talk to you about you absolutely coming over into the realms of the kingdom of God and shutting down everything that belongs to an earthly realm, because God paid a price for you too, and it's a heavenly vision. There's a lot of people that are saying they're going to heaven. They're not going to heaven. Jesus made it very clear. He said, those who do the will of the Father is very clearly expressed. And I'm going to tell you right now, that's not your will. Your will is not His will. His will is far above our will. His thoughts far above our thoughts. His words, His mind, His things far above us. Good, I'm going to get to Him just a little bit. Because He's what it's about tonight. Kidding. Thank you for standing up and keeping the little guy in my face, because we want to dedicate him to be consecrated, to always be in the house of the Lord. We want to dedicate him to be consecrated, to be always in the house of the Lord. It does not matter what goes down. I'm going to tell you, it's a spiritual decision. You listen to me. Those of you who are watching me by web, it is a spiritual decision for you to be within distance to get here, and you decide not to come, that you're going to stay home. And I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to warn you. This isn't about me. This is not about my motivation. It's not about my success. It's not about how many heads are in church. It's about your soul, how God's going to be able to use you, and whether you're making heaven or not. Because there's a lot of people that say Lord, Lord, and they're not coming in. There's a lot of people who describe that somehow that they belong to the living God, but their fruits of their life don't show it. And I want to talk to you about that tonight. I want to get radical with you. I want you to understand that Christ Jesus ever lives to make intercession for the saints. Over the years, since for 1971 years, there have been several different people in each generation that would get that and recognize, wait a minute, he ever lives to make intercession for the saints, then that's what I'm called to do. My life has got to be rearranged. See, people, we can't get people into understanding the very fundamentals of how the moving of God takes place. There is an expression that has to be going forth from our life if we are going to be fulfilling God's will and purpose for our life. And that expression is faith, expectation, and love. Faith, I mean mountain-moving faith, faith that subdues everything, faith that without it is impossible to please God, a supernatural working of the power of God through our lives that ministers the gospel, that breaks off the yoke. See, people, I'm going to tell you right now, you listen to me. If we spend some time with God, the Holy Ghost, we'll get a deep urgency on the inside of us that'll cause us to see things different. We'll think different. We'll have a compassion for a lost and dying world that supersedes anything you can even imagine. You won't have to try to wake up in the night. You'll hear God calling you and you'll get up. You won't lay there and count sheep, so to speak. You'll get up and pray for the lost and the sheep. Every generation, there's been a people who've been willing to be mobilized by God and respond to God and begin to take up this cause with Him, because He ever lives to make intercession for the saints. And understand, He's still saying this, can't you watch with me for 1 hour? He's still saying, can't you watch with me for 1 hour? Watch what? Watch with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Because not only, you know, of course, Christ Jesus in Luke, when he was describing the end of time and the Antichrist spirit and the falling away, he said, watch and pray that you may be found worthy. Listen to Jesus. These are Jesus' words. That you may be found worthy to escape all these things that shall come upon the earth and stand before the Son of Man. People don't get it. Everybody's turned to their own way. They're doing their own thing. And somehow we write God into it and we expect that somehow he's going to be pleased if we'll just throw him a bone. God's not that way. He's come to give us his life and calls us to be completely consecrated to his life. Not just some part of our life. And that's what I mean by throwing him a bone. Because it's disrespectful. It's just on that level. Just trying to please the barking dog. Trying to please the demanding voice. We're going to have to turn. We have to turn. Listen, there are two most important things that have got to be in your life if you're going to see faith, expectation, and love. You know,
1 Corinthians 13:13 says, now abides faith, expectation, and love. And I know many people's Bibles translates it faith, hope, and charity. It's faith, expectation, and love. That's exactly what it is. That's what it means. It just helps you to understand that hope is a little bit higher, or what elpsis, the Greek word elpsis, is a little bit higher than just a hope so. It's an expecting. Because I'm telling you right now, not a lot's going to happen if you just hope so. But if you're in expectation, if you come up to someone and you ask them if they're saved, and they say, I hope so, my desire, or I could even say, I hope, because I'm not sure, certain, right? Because it'd be good application. I hope that you recognize that they need to be brought to a place of assurance, because they don't know. Expectation, faith, expectation. And love. Love is the means by which everything that God manifests about our about who He is through our life, everything that heaven is, how heaven is going to be revealed, it's going to be revealed through love. It was Jesus Christ moved by compassion that He came and bore our sins at Calvary. And He didn't say, y'all, you go free. In the sense of there's no work left to do. He says, take up your cross and follow me. The old song says, should Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No, there's a cross for everyone. There's a cross for me. Huh? Do you want to live your own life, or do you want to live the life of Christ? Did Jesus die at Calvary Cross for you to have a career? No. For you to decide it? Do you make it up as you go? For you to decide what you're going to do, how you're going to live your life? People don't realize it right now, but they're sitting at home. And to me, it's a manifestation of the spiritual wickedness. I know you've been drifting. I didn't know you drifted that far. And I'm going to tell you right now, it won't be long, and you'll lose sight of land. And once you lose sight of land and you have no compass, you don't know where you are. You don't know where you are. And then in that state, deception will begin to kick in, and the enemy of your soul will make it seem like you're on vacation in the right place, going right where you think you're supposed to be going. Listen to me. Listen to me. Dear people, I'm so glad you're here. Maybe some of you had to fight hell to be here tonight. Well, praise God, because I'm going to tell you right now, we have so lost seeking God, we don't even know how to keep His sanctuary. We don't even know how to keep the assembly. We don't even know how to keep a holy convocation. We've so drifted from seeking God. Seeking God is supposed to be something of our life every day. When I'm talking about the expressions of the life of God, faith, expectation, and love, that's fueled by, with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with thanksgiving. Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 18. It is a big part, listen to me, that is a big part of being able to stand against spiritual wickedness. Otherwise, you're going to be taken out. Amen. Who can stand against spiritual wickedness? Praise God for the Holy Spirit, who's come and lead us and guide us into all the truth. But if we don't cooperate with them, then we're going to be taken out. Right. Once again, all the revivals of the past that everybody glamorizes and likes to think about, and should, because it's awesome. Happened because somebody realized, some people realized that they were born of God and they no longer lived, and their whole life was about revealing heaven on earth. And their whole life was now about seeking God and giving their whole being for the purpose of the Holy Spirit to be able to manifest Jesus Christ through their lives. The brook Jabbok, or the river Jabbok, where Jacob contended with the Lord. It's not just for him. It's for you and me too. Mount Carmel, where Elijah began to cry out to God and intercede. It's not just for Elijah. It's for you and me too. Yeah. The agony of Gethsemane is where Christ Jesus called us to come, but very few will come there. Those who come there have changed the world, have fulfilled the will of the Father, have done what Father asked them to do. And there's always a Pentecostal joy on the backside of the agony of Gethsemane. Praise God. I mean, you think about the great burden and the great compassion that Paul had for Israel. He said, I would that I was cut off, anathema, cursed in hell for my brethren's sake. If it was make it possible for them to be saved, I would go to hell for them. That's some serious compassion. No, that I would be anathema, Romans chapter 9, that I would be accursed for my brethren's sake. Come on, sataya, apateka. There's a love that God wants to have revealed through us. There's a compassion that God wants to have revealed for us. And it's not going to happen while you pursue your own interest. You're going to have to deal with your problem and get rid of it. If you walk out of here tonight or listen to me tonight and you end up with condemnation, it's simply an expression that you heard the word of God, but you're unwilling to obey. Because this is the call of God that is supposed to work within your life, a solid revelation and conviction and a response to say, Father, I'll do your will. I'm going to follow you. And many people hear the word of God and they don't want to respond. They try to sit there and process it and try to work God's will into their will. I'm going to tell you right now, as soon as you begin to do that, as soon as you try to compromise in any way a sanctified life, you've polluted it altogether and you made it something different. Somebody said, oh, it's what does it matter? I'm at home and I'm listening on the web. It matters everything. You're forsaking the assembly. It's different here than it is there. Ellie brought a woman down from San Francisco, and she sent me an email. She said, do you think I should drive down? I've never been in a meeting like this. Do you think I should drive down every weekend? Because it's just not the same watching it on the web. Yeah. I couldn't tell her to drive down here every weekend. But I'm going to tell you right now, Father heard that, because that goes straight to heaven. There's not a decision that we make. There's not a word in our mouth, but the Father sees it. He hears it altogether. I'm crying out, Psalms 139. I'm crying out, God, set me before. In other words, yoke me before and behind. Even as you would yoke an oxen or yoke a horse. Oh, Lord, take a hold of the reins of my life and cause me to come under. Seize me with your power and lay your hand upon me that I won't move without. I would not move outside of that which you purpose, because I'm telling you right now, just because your preacher said it doesn't mean it's true. Did the Word of God say it? I watch so many people. They give so much time and energy to the study of earthly things, and if they would get as serious about the book, the Word of God, as they are about everything else, their whole lives would be changed. Because all of a sudden they had recognized that the things that they've been hearing mostly from the pulpit isn't altogether true. And all bigger than that, the Word of God is spirit and life. The Scripture says the flesh profits nothing. They that sow to the flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, a stench. You hear me? A stench. They that sow to the flesh shall of the flesh reap a stench. The flesh profits nothing. It's the Spirit that makes alive. They that sow to the Spirit shall reap the very life of God, eternal life. You got to understand. He said, my Word is spirit and life. And it's like pulling teeth from a chicken to get God's people in this time to give themselves to the Word of God. You can read the Bible in 1 year, reading 3 chapters a day. In 1 year, you can read the entire Bible, 3 chapters a day. It takes less than 5 minutes, unless you're a slow reader. Then maybe it's 6 or 7. It isn't much more. And maybe you can't read. Well, there's tapes. You can get a whole bunch of different tapes, soundtracks, CDs, iPod, whatever. It's a good investment for an iPod, whatever. You can hear the Word of God being read to you. 5 minutes. What is the guy's name? Alexander Scorby will read 3 chapters to you in less than 5 minutes. And if you don't, and you need to follow along in your Bible if you don't know how to read, so that you pay attention to the words and you'll learn, because God will teach you. He's taught other men of God. Where do you think Wigglesworth came to become known as the father, as the apostle of faith? He gave himself into a consecrated life of living out the life that Christ Jesus described. Where do you think that praying high became to be called the apostle of prayer and intercession? Because he surrendered himself over to a life of living out this gospel. Can you not watch with me 1 hour? Can you not pray with 1 hour, just 1 hour? Can't you watch and pray with me just 1 hour? Jesus is still saying that today, because he ever lives to make intercession for the saints. And it is the prayer of the Spirit and the Word of God that is going to fuel these authorities, these expressions of faith, expectation, and love in our life. Love, I mean, if I just spend time talking about all of these three things right here and breaking them down, I'll spend the rest of the night, but I've got to go somewhere else. So I'm loading you up with thick stuff. I'm loading you up with about every phrase I speak. Really, on all honesty, I could spend an hour or two on it. And so this isn't just some kind of, you know, little you know, Sunday school meeting. This is for you to sit up at the table and feast on the things of the Spirit. Yes. That will then result in divine strength and power and ability to go do what God said to do, to no longer live your life but live His. Hallelujah. 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 Man, I got so many sermons running right through my head right now just on this. I've got to try to rein myself in. I've got to try to get myself over here to what I know what want to know if Father wants to deliver. I mean, you think that you can live without praying with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit and watching thereunto with thanksgiving, but you can't. You're being taken out. That's why people don't know how to get over addiction. That's how they don't know how to live free, or they don't know how to live free from sin. It's why they don't really connect with the life and the heart of Jesus. It's why they don't know how to flow and function in the Holy Ghost, because they don't take God serious. They don't take His Word serious. Tonight, I pray that you will change. I pray that you won't even walk out of here with a mentality of trying to find room for God. I pray you walk out of here with a mentality of trying to find room for you.
Yeah.
Hello. Yeah. I'm telling you, the Lord put a word in my mouth and told me to go everywhere and speak it, tell the church to receive the life of Jesus. I mean, our schedule is already slammed till May, and it's booking up through the rest of the year, because when the Lord puts a word in your mouth, He's going to open up the door for you to go and do it without you trying to make it happen and try to do nothing. He just said, do it. And I said, okay, whatever, Father. Listen, I would hate to think that there's somebody in here tonight who's unwilling to hear, receive the life of Jesus, and you want to just continue on with your career. If your career and what you're doing is not about the expression of the life of Jesus, I'm telling you, you're on another road. It's called a broad one. And many go there, and it's a road leading straight to destruction. There is a way unto the Lord. It's very narrow. His way is narrow, and few find it. Because many people are unwilling to ever really come to terms with whether or not they're living to do the will of the Father or doing their own will. When you begin to live to do the will of the Father and the Spirit of the Son and the Spirit of the Lord and the hunger that He places within our lives by this wonderful work of grace, it causes you to hunger and thirst after His Word. It causes you to hunger and thirst after His life. That's righteousness. Seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, my goodness, that's His life. That's the life of the Spirit. We make all these various different ideas out of it. We're so heady. People just want to learn some more knowledge instead of learning and come to a place of understanding how to live out the life of God, how to reach the lost, how to move in the anointing, how to take hold of the gifts of the Spirit and function in them. I'm telling you right now, those of you who learned how by the Spirit of the Lord to speak by the Spirit in tongues, if you would just give yourself to more prayer, to where that prayer of the Spirit would turn into the prayer of understanding, every one of you would know how to interpret tongues. Amen. The whole reason you don't is because you never have. What happens when you begin to pray until the glory comes? Instead of just prayer, because it's a religious activity and religious duty, because you got to get some time in. Somehow you got to squeeze some room in for God as you pursue the things of your own interest to pay for your own bills. That you've made them God's bills. They're not God's bills. You made those bills. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Father wants to bless us with all kinds of wonderful blessings, but if it turns our hearts from Him, I'm going to tell you right now, it's a damnation. You hear me? And many people's blessings have turned their hearts from God, even as it did Israel. The Lord didn't tell us to go and learn a lesson from Hebrews chapter 3 and Hebrews chapter 4 because He was just kidding. He told us to go and learn a lesson of how they fell after unbelief so that we didn't make the same error. Amen. We're making the same error. That there's going to be some people, the millennials are coming. The millennials are coming, and I'm going to tell you right now, I'm not going to be left out. I'm going to be a leader in the millennials. The millennials are coming. People who are sold out for God are not willing or interested to continue on living a double standard, a dual life.
Amen.
Huh? I'd rather believe in a dual nature and not live one than to not believe in a dual nature and live one. You hear what I'm saying? Because I see a lot of people living a dual life, a dual nature life. God gives us His Word in splendor and power and glory and might, and people just act like it's just something that they can choose whether or not they like that dish or not. Whether you know or not, or whether you recognize or not, I'm fired up. God tells us very clearly. He says, build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. That's not optional. And that's not some harsh heartache of a thing to do. It's joy unspeakable and full of glory. But I'm going to tell you right now, God will place upon you a burden for a nation as He did John Hyde. I don't know that you'll go all the way as John did. He couldn't sleep. I read his biography today. Somebody witnessed it as he was praying. One night they just were up because they had some kind of a heartburn or some kind of chest problems. And they just so happened to have out their window a view of John Hyde's cottage. Where it was when he was in India. They saw the light go on at 2 o'clock in the morning. The light went off at about midnight. The light came on about 2 o'clock in the morning. The light came on again at 3 o'clock in the morning. The light came on again at 5 o'clock in the morning and stayed on. That's his routine. Come on, people. He didn't do it out of religion. He did it because he got so close to the anointing and so close to the presence of God that his heart was reunited with the passions of God. And so he lived out a refreshing life. However, you know, it's like my dear friend Tim Hall, evangelist Tim Hall said. He said, I was asking God, seeking God one day. Allie, do you need help? Do you need somebody to help you? Are you good? Because I want you guys to be in the meeting. Nobody's bothering me. I'll carry him around. I'll carry him around. I promise you.
Yes.
You know why? You know why? I feel an urgency. Listen to me. I feel an urgency, and I don't know that everybody's getting it, but you know what I am very excited to see? I hear more and more people talking about the need for prayer. I hear more and more people calling for a holy convocation of people to come and pray and intercede. That encourages me. Because I know that's what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. I know what happens when you just get under the Word. Because, look, people, if you gave yourself to a lifestyle of seeking God, you'd be in every meeting.
True.
You'd be here early. And by the way, prayer starts an hour before the meeting. If you can arrange God into your life a little bit more. If you can work Him into your schedule. If you could find room for Him in your daytimer. And I'm going to lay it out to you like that. Okay? I'm going to lay it out in the most insultive way I can.
Awesome.
That I may captivate your attention.
Yes.
That I may offend your mind. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. To reveal your heart. So taramaya. And if your heart's wrong, then you can now have the floodlight of heaven shining right there so you can see the big need. Habasutirinapaya. People, I don't talk to people here in this church as little babies. We go out ministering, I usually just feed people with a little bit of baby milk because that's all the Holy Ghost allows. I'm talking to people that Father is calling into the ranks of a Holy Ghost army to burn bright with His person, with His life, and with His glory. Yeah, you can't sit around. You have no right to sit around here and not obey and pursue the things of the Spirit. You have no right. You're doing yourself damage. You're doing yourself damage. We call to the very life of Jesus, not pretend religion.
Amen.
We're called to live by the Spirit, the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And there's only one way to do it. Jesus showed us how. I may come back and talk a little bit more about these things, but I wanted to real quickly run you through a whole bunch of verse of scripture about how Jesus gave His life to prayer. Because you got to understand, it is prayer and the Word that is going to fuel the life of Christ Jesus being made manifest in our lives. You got to get it. Now abides faith, confidence, and love. And the greatest of these is love. Huh? And understand, in that context, what the Lord is crying out for us to do. So we see Jesus, Luke 5:16, look at Him. He withdrew Himself into a desolate wilderness place to pray. This is what He was always doing. I want you to get it. Jesus, what Jesus did. He was captivated by the heart of the Father. It wasn't just little casual prayers, mental assent prayers, human understanding prayers. This is a prayer of God. Jesus is God manifested in flesh. Plus, He was depending upon the Holy Ghost. This is prayer in the Holy Ghost. There's a lot of people who go to pray. They never pray in the Spirit. They may even have some tongues, but that prayer never did take on the demeanor and the glory and begin to affect their very personality and passions and appetite and attitude. You fell far short of being engaged in the life of God, in the life of Jesus Christ. This isn't some law. Hey, listen to me. Some legal thing can never do. Some conceited legalism can never possibly attempt to live the life of Jesus, to live the life of God. Somebody said it's legalism. That's nonsense. Trying to escape the call of God to be different from demonic powers in the world. That's all. You know what? It doesn't work. It don't work in heaven. It don't work in logic. It don't work in the Word. It don't work in the Spirit. It's all nonsense. Jesus died, was buried, rose again, so that you and I could be dead together with Him, crucified together with Him, buried together with Him, raised up together with Him to live together with Him, seated in the heavenly realm, to live by the Holy Ghost, to live as the temple of the living God, where He lives in us and walks in us, where God the Holy Ghost is with us and in us, where we're baptized in His glory and His presence, where the anointing of heaven flows out of our life like rivers of expression. People, why is it that so many people want to play, want to play pretend with God? I mean, when's the last time you had a river? A river of divine expression. Huh? I had one just a few minutes ago. I'm having one right now. When's the last time you had one? Huh? When's the last time you were so taken over by the power of God you couldn't even find yourself? Huh? When's the last time you were so overwhelmed by God, it didn't matter what you prayed for, it was going to happen? The place of your whole room. Listen, it's born in the prayer room. Jesus said it's born in the prayer room. In the closet, shut in with God. You know what I really hate? Giving out this kind of bread and feeling some resistance. You know, if you're resisting this, raise your right hand, then take it and slap yourself with it.
Amen.
Because you're playing pretend. You're playing make-believe. Because they're only the Word of God stands for us as a witness to what is right and wrong. Not your opinion, not your denominational doctrines, what His Word says. His Word is plain. It's not for wise scholars and people who have great brilliance. It's for people who have been converted, become like little babes, and are simple and being willing to be taught of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Let's continue on this list here. Luke chapter 6, verse 12. It came to pass in those days that He went into a mountain and prayed and continued all night in prayer to God. Anybody want to follow Jesus?
Yes.
And I'm just giving it to you in Luke so that you don't get all heady and start wondering whether or not this is a repetition of something previous. Jesus lived a life of prayer. He called you and I to live a life of prayer. Now I'm going to get to the book of Acts here in a few minutes and show you the outworking in the church and understand why Paul said always be instant in prayer. Huh? Continuing in prayer. Pray without ceasing. Huh? The prayer of the Spirit, who's making continual intercession for us according to the will of God. You're not going to walk with God if you don't give yourself to the things of the Spirit. If you're not willing to be shut in with God the Holy Ghost in prayer, you're never going to be living a sanctified, consecrated life. You're going to live a polluted life. And you're going to try to persuade me that you're going to be right with God and make heaven with a polluted life. And I tell you, the whole Bible is set against you. I tell you, God so radically changed us through the wonderful grace of salvation, He describes it as being born again, washed with the water of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, a complete and distinct, unique creation that no longer just a mere human being, but belongs to the very family of God. Hello. It's another race. It's another race. It's the kingdom of God race. God's my father. People said, oh, God's the father of everybody. No, He's not. The devil is the father of everybody until they're born of the Spirit by the miracle work of Christ Jesus. Understand. We've got to understand a distinction about our lives. If we recognize that we belong to another race, that we are the citizens of heaven, that we are born of the Spirit, heirs of God, co-inheritors with Christ Jesus, because of this wonderful thing that God has done, maybe we're going to begin to move in to the occupation that God has given to us. Instead of living out a religious life, bivocational with God. Give me a break. You walk with God? Yeah, I'm bivocational. I walk with Him sometimes, but most of the time I walk with me. We're going to end that tonight in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Jesus went in an isolated place. Pray. Why? sweet communion. Try it sometime. It's very, you'll like it so much you'll want to do it all the time. But try it sometime where you so enjoy the presence of God, you captivated and raptured, and all of a sudden, heaven becomes more real to you than the earthly things that have captivated you. Oh, hallelujah. Huh. In the beauty of His glory, in the awesomeness of what He's doing, the world is crucified to you and you're crucified to it. You're a stench to everybody that doesn't believe, but a sweet aroma to those who are saints in God. I mean, that's just what happens. Huh. You are just excited about living out the life of the Spirit, the life of the living God. I mean, come on, think about it. You know, you get a choice. You're going to live your stinky life or you're going to live a glorious eternal life, a stinky temporal life. And tell me that it's not stinky. And if you can argue with me, I'll start bringing the facts to bear. But I don't want to have to do that tonight. God's given us a glorious life, an eternal life. Woo! The life of the Spirit. Once again, people have drifted so far from seeking God, they can't even get to church. Many people have drifted so far from God, they can't even get to... They drifted so far from seeking God, they can't even make church regularly on Sunday morning. And that is far from the context of what's described in Hebrews chapter 13. When he said, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together as a manner of some is. And tells us to assemble ourselves all the more together as we see the time approaching. That was in the context of 2 services a day, 7 days a week. So we got to take it to 3. Well, all I want to just see you, respond tonight to the cry of the one who makes ever lives to make intercession, can you not watch with me for 1 hour? I want you to understand the value of watching for 1 hour. I want you to understand your participation with the Holy Ghost and the change that takes place, because as you walk, as you see Him, as you interact with Him, as you behold Him, I'm going to tell you right now, you embrace the light that He's freely given. Suddenly you begin to understand the power of a sanctified, consecrated life and how easy it is to walk in if you're willing to walk in the Spirit, the Holy Ghost. It's not a hard and complicated thing. It's a glorious life. Hallelujah. But you're going to have to get in the program. Quit being offline with God. I mean, you get some things when you work offline, if you've downloaded it. But you don't have all the resources at your fingertips. Huh? And after a while, you're going to be way behind. You know what I'm saying? I'm just trying to, get to you. I'm trying to get at you in any way I possibly can. And of course, for those of you that are taking notes, which sometimes I forget about that, I just did, and that's why I'm trying to slow down, give people more scripture references, because I'm going to do anything. I'm going to try anything that helps. Luke 5:16, Luke 6:12, I've already read those. Luke 9:18, it came to pass that he was alone praying. His disciples were with him, and he asked them, saying, once again, there he's alone praying. You can find, basically, what I'm showing you in every other chapter, you're going to find Jesus alone praying. And he's trying to help us understand how to do something and the outworking of that. If we'll just be willing to follow him. And then, of course, Luke 9:28, and it came to pass about 8 days after these sayings, he took Peter, John, and James, and he went up into a mountain to pray. And as he prayed, see, this time he's going to kind of let them in on why he's constantly going alone by himself. Yeah. He's going to let them in on the good things that can happen if you learn how to touch heaven, let heaven touch you. Yeah. Huh? Because they were asking him about praying, how to pray, and why you're praying. And Basta Kinamashi, Mandasta Kia. Excuse me. I've been hollering at the Lord all day. I've been hollering at out of the Spirit, the things that are trying to stop what God wants to advance, and especially on your case and your cause. I'm watching for your soul. I'm so earnest to see the things that would glorify the name of Jesus Christ be revealed in the earth, but you can't continue on with your occupation and have His. Somebody's going to have to deny themselves, take up their cross. Huh? Somebody's going to have to sell their big house and get themselves a smaller house so they can live more modestly, so they don't have to spend all their time making money to try to keep up with their bills and keep up with their bills until they're so old they're not useful anymore because you can barely even walk around. Well, I wonder where I can go. My legs don't work. You can't really go anywhere. Down the street, go preach somebody down the street. So many people give themselves to just studying the Bibles because they want knowledge. They never give themselves to learning how to flow in the Holy Ghost to reach the lost and dying world and to move in the things of the Spirit. It's nonsense. I want you to let God confront you tonight. Yes. Hallelujah. Watch out that the blessing of God don't turn your heart from heaven. Luke 11, chapter 1, and it came to pass that as he was praying in a certain place, when he ceased, one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray as John also taught his disciples to pray. I'm telling you, you got a bunch of praying people on the earth. Hallelujah. You've got so many examples of people who cry out to God. Father said, this he said, call unto me, cry out to me. Call unto me and I will show you great and marvelous things which you've not known. You wouldn't be half sad as you are if you gave yourself over to the things of God. You wouldn't be half as upset as you are if you found a place to give yourself over to the Word of God and to the Spirit of God. You wouldn't be half beset as you are. Huh? And you know, I look at that contrast of beset. Lay aside the weight and the sin that so easily beset you, which is a word that literally means yoked. That yokes you. I like rather, he has beset me or he has yoked me in front and in behind, laid his hand upon me. I'm telling you, when you got something and you got it by the reins in front and you got it by the reins behind, I'm telling you, right, it's going nowhere except for where you're leading it. Hallelujah. Ha ha. Hallelujah. See, the new covenant, he causes us. He, as it were, makes us. He causes us to walk in his statutes and his judgments. But you've got to participate. You've got to voluntarily participate to get into the cause, to the make, to his leading, to his guiding, to him taking us to the places where the wonderful, glorious power of the person of Jesus Christ might be made manifest through our life and a nation shaken by the power of God. I want to see a city shaken by the power of God. I want to see a region shaken by the power of God. I want to see a state shaken by the power of God. I want to see a nation shaken by the power of God. I want to see nations shaken by the power of God. That ain't going to happen because we say praise God, hallelujah. That's wonderful. It's going to happen because you're going to find yourself a place of Gethsemane. And a place of Pentecost every day. A place of enjoying his presence and enjoying the activity of just being in his, in this intimacy with him. Where he begins to move you to speak out his words. To declare those things. I believe a nobody sitting or kneeled down on their knees in the remote regions of the earth can change the outcome of nations. Yes. That's the power of prayer. Amen. We've never discovered it because we spent little time with it. We've been busy and preoccupied with that which perishes with the using. Those temporal things, those earthly things. I'm going to tell you right now, I can go, I can take you and I can mark events. People like to talk about what we did with Revive San Diego when the Lord gave us that huge property there on the Naval Training Center. I'm telling you right now, God called me to a prayer room. I invited many people to come. Usually there's only one person there with me, and that was Joseph Deskins. But God told me to come. I invited everybody to come. I sit there in that prayer room for 1 year. I know what it resulted in. He said, I want you here. Of course, it wasn't just there that I prayed. You listen to me. Prayer changes things. Prayer arranges all of the situations around us so that you and I can begin to move in the empowerment that God has for us. Yeah. Until you're willing to do it, ain't nothing going to happen. As long as you're heady and even heady, high-minded, always thinking about how it is it benefits you or whether or not you agree with it, you're never going to get anywhere with God. You're done. You're toast. You listening to me? Yes. Hello? Yes. Just checking to make sure you're still here. Nobody's fallen asleep on me yet. Change. God's giving you the power of change. I'm not even talking about discipline. I'm talking about surrender. See, surrender is a higher realm than discipline.
Yes, it is.
Surrender to the Holy Ghost so that he can lead you. To be led, to be guided, to walk in, to live by. That's a whole lot of giving God control over your life. Somebody said, you can't force anybody. I'm going to tell you right now, it depends on who's praying. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Because I saw the messengers of the Lord lay hold on Lot, who was hesitating, and grabbed him by the hand, and the language is forced him out the place. Because they were under a restraint because of a relationship that Abraham had with God. I'll tell you right now, that's one way to see your family come into the kingdom. Yeah. Hallelujah. When you start getting yourself into a place of intimacy with God because you're willing to obey Him and walk this life of the Spirit out with Him and do it His way. He's called us to all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. He called us to come and follow Him. Prayer is one of those words that you're going to find used more than any other word in the Bible. It's one of those most popular words of the text. Huh? That seems to be... It isn't... Somebody say, oh, it's not my calling. No, it's your refusal to the call. Forget about it's not my calling. It's everybody's calling. It's just that few respond to the call. I say it again. It is everyone's calling. Huh? I mean, I could say this really sweet and quiet, but it doesn't seem to work. So I'm trying something new. It is everyone's calling.
Yes.
But only a few respond to the call.
Yes.
I'm passionate about this. Can you tell?
Yes.
I want you to be passionate about it.
Yes.
I don't know about you, man, but I start reading about people praying. I just cry. I start sobbing. I start repenting, huh? I start reading about people praying all night, people on their face before God 5 to 8 hours over the lost and dying world. I just start sobbing, huh? When I read Evan Roberts, God said to Evan Roberts, He woke him up and said, "Call unto me, and I'll show you great mighty things." I remember when the Lord used to wake me up at 3:33 in the morning, say, "Call unto me." And I never responded fully like other men did. I just responded a little. I'm going to respond more fully. But I think I responded more than most. But that still doesn't matter. I'm not sitting there going, I responded more than most. I mean, I'm just trying to call the God's conviction. I'm trying to provoke you. To get with the program. To don't lose out on the great callings and commissions of your life, that you can live a glorious heavenly life, that you can take your place among the sons of God, among the saints of the Most High, to live out something that goes far beyond any opportunities that is in the earthly realm and among men. Come on. You don't need anybody to empower you. God's empowered you. You don't need anybody to make room for you. Christ Jesus made room for you. I'm sorry it's a cross, but He'll get... You'll find how glorious it is. As you go bearing precious seed and come again rejoicing, bringing the souls with you. I was in a church the other night in Texas, and it was a power of God just swept the place. It was wonderful. And I come out, and just with such authority and such a moving, I just had this song in my heart. When the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, we were as them that dreamed. Then was our mouth filled with laughter and our tongues with singing. Then said they among the heathen, the Lord has done great things for them. And the pastor's wife was standing there kind of a little, you know, saucer-eyed saying, the Lord just gave me that for this year. And why was I seeing it? Because I was so excited about the possibility that suddenly there would be, He would revive His work again in the midst of us. Suddenly, God's people would be mobilized again in the day of His power. Suddenly, there would come a great moving in the Spirit. And somebody would respond. People would begin to respond to that heavenly vision and that heavenly purpose. Now to fully give themselves over to a consecrated life, sanctified by the fires of the Holy Ghost, shaped by the very image of Jesus. Tonight, God's calling you. I said, tonight, God's calling you.
Yes.
Listen to me. Tonight, God's calling you.
Yes.
You can go back to your Plexus or your Lexus or whatever else, but tonight, God's calling you. Tonight, God's calling you. You can go back to your romance with the world, your house and your other thrills, but tonight, God's calling you.
Yes.
You can clothe yourself and array yourself with all the splendor that the flesh may have, but tonight, God's calling you. You can have all, be armed with all your excuses of why not. But tonight, God's calling you.
Yeah.
He's calling you out. He's calling you into His kingdom. He's calling you to take your place among the mighty.
Yes.
Now David will start talking about his three, and then his other three, and then his other three. I love Jesus. See Jesus take his three. Said, let me show you what happens when you pray. Let me show you what happens. He suddenly was transfigured before them. Metamorpho. That word is used just one other time, especially in the Bible, and it's Romans 12, 2. Don't be conformed to the world, but be transfigured, metamorpho, by thinking different about yourself, understanding you're a citizen of heaven,
yes,
the heir of God and the co-inheritor with Christ Jesus. You've been filled and baptized in the Holy Ghost. God, the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of the Lord has come upon you greater than he came upon Elijah. The Spirit of the Lord has come upon you greater than he's come upon any man in former times. We have a whole lot more, and it seems we do far less with it. When a man of God said to pray and hide when he left for India in 1904 and said, I'm praying that you receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost. He read the note, watered up, and threw it down in anger. I can't believe that person act like I'm not filled with the Holy Ghost. That night he couldn't sleep. Because his heart is true with the Lord, so now the seed has been planted. Then he began to cry out, oh God, oh God. Huh? 1904, a stirring came in the earth. Huh? And it's a sovereign moving of God. Yes, it's a stirring. We saw the stirring of 1904. And you could place things all over the earth that was taking place from India to Wales to the United States of America, all over, stirrings all over the world, Italy, all over the world. But it was just a few who responded. Because God stirs sovereignly, but what if no man responds? What if God stirs sovereignly, yet no man responded? What if God woke me up at 3:33 in the morning and said, call unto me? Same thing he said to praying hide. Call unto me and I'll show you great and mighty things which you've not known. But I wouldn't respond because I was too sleepy because I got a bunch of stuff I want to do for me tomorrow. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Can anybody hear me?
Yes.
I'm gonna respond. I'm gonna take my cross and follow him. I'm not gonna ask for a cushy one. I'm gonna take the heavy end too. Hello. Come on now. Standing around arguing whether you're gonna get the heavy end or the light end, whether it's rough or smooth, whether it's got a cushion. Come on, people. I'm telling you, I can feel some of you taking hold of these things here in the spirit.
Well, I'm sitting here, Pastor, tonight trying to figure out how to work God into my plans. I'm trying to figure out how to work God into the things I've already decided to do.
I'm rebuking that right now. I'm breaking that thing down. I'm breaking that yoke down. He's very clearly called us what to do. Told us what to do. Huh? You're listening to me. Matthew 14, 23. This is clearly a distinct event. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went over to the fellowship hall and said, wow, have you ever seen anything like that? Did you see how many people just got fed? How many multitudes just got fed from those few fishes? My, this was, did you see those arms grow out? Did you see that? Did you see those eyes pop open? Did you see all the dead people that was raised from life? He didn't do that, did he?
No.
It was a great miracles that just taken place. He didn't do what we did. But where's the campaign manager? We need to get some videos of this thing. Did we get videos tonight? Did the tape turn out good? Because we got to start telling everybody. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
He went up to a mountain alone for his intimacy with Father. It's what brings you into the anointing and brings you into the move of God and brings you into greatness and keeps you preserved from falling away. Hallelujah. The Lord's allowed me to get up and smell the breath and see the details of people's lives who did not have a solid relationship with God, with Christ Jesus. And were allowed to be used in greatness. And the condition of their spiritual life afterwards. And I might not be the smartest book on the shelf, but I'm not altogether stupid. I recognize Father saying, here's what I want you to do. I'm showing you something. Come, son of man, what do you see? Are you in the midst of the moving of the Spirit of God? Are you in the midst of a walk with God? Are you in the midst of living out His life in relationship with Him? Are you just going it on your own? If you're just going it on your own, you're just bumbling and fumbling and stumbling through life and just taking everything as just happenstance and coincidence and whatever. But when you're moving in God, all of a sudden your eyes open. You're able to see. Wait a minute. Father's showing me something again. Oh, now God's speaking to me again. Oh, praise God. Now He's calling me to do this. You're just able to get quiet enough to hear the voice. You recognize that everything that's going on in your life is ordered of the Lord. Hallelujah. And now all of a sudden you quit taking for granted all that God is doing and you're not blind anymore to seeing what He's showing you or deaf to hearing what He's saying. Hallelujah.
Praise the name of Jesus. Kana mositi alahat. He yoked me from in the front and in the back, and He's laid His hand upon me. Hallelujah. Whew. That's almost as good of a description of being of Him coming and creating a new heart and a new spirit, and now Christ being formed in me and the Holy Ghost coming and living in my life, which He's made His temple, and then now baptizing me in the fire of His glory and of His presence, and then now standing alongside of me and saying, here, walk this way. You're listening to me because that's what the New Testament describes. Are you hearing me? Yes. Can anybody hear me? Yes. Should I say that again? You mean walk through that again? He gave me a new heart and He gave me a new spirit and a new birth and formed Himself, Christ in me, the confidence of glory. Made my being the temple of the Holy Ghost. Baptized me in the Holy Ghost and fire, His glorious presence. And now stands right alongside of me saying, come and walk with me this way. I'm about to dance and run, shout, and jump, and leap, do backflips. Come on, Mike. Woo! Hallelujah. Man, when these things become real to you, you do run. You do leap. You do shout. You do respond. As long as they are not something that's become a part of your life, they're aloof to you. It's not touched by it. You cold, indifferent, and lukewarm to the fire of His Word. Just sit right there. Because I'm a flamethrower in the kingdom of God. And we're going to get you all burned up here in a few minutes. Yeah. Hallelujah. Ha! Hallelujah. Anybody who's willing, hallelujah, come on over here and got to take control. Praise the Lord. I'm telling you, I got a passionate cry to God. Come drag every one of you out of the self realm. Ha! Into the glory realm. Vashipaya ramandache. Marashuri nahase. Hallelujah. I can see a place for you all over the nations of the earth right now. I know exactly where you fit. Hallelujah.
Because the laborers are few. The human resources are few. Luke 18:1, Jesus said, spoke a parable. This is why men always should pray and not to faint. Because that persistent prayer is going to get you whatever you asked. And hopefully everything that you're asking, and this is the context, is about the power and the glory and the anointing. You know, Finney said revival, and look at his definition of revival. He'd walk into a place and the whole place would be shattered by the power of God. The place would be shut down by the anointing. He said revival is no more a miracle than reaping a crop of wheat. It is something that you labor into, you sow into it, and then it's theirs, it's there for you to have. The problem is we have few laborers. Because when Jesus called for laborers, He's asking for laborers in the context of how He labored and how He intimately knew God. And He's telling you and me, if we want that, if we want to participate with what Father has for us, we're supposed to come and imitate Him. Oh, we're too busy. Oh, how does that work in my fashion, my plan, my will, my purpose? The wind is blowing.
Yes, it is.
The wind that separates the wheat from the chaff is blowing right here, right now. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. The call of God here. The sheep hear his voice. The sheep begin to come. Not reluctantly, they begin to come. They know his voice, they know the voice of the master. The prayer of boldness that's right before this in Luke chapter 11. Jesus, tell us about the power of prayer. I love how he said it in Mark chapter 11, verse 24 and 25. He said, you pray and you believe you received it, you got it. I want to talk to you a little bit more quickly about God, his empowerment to us, of his assurance that when we get in this realm, when we get in this realm and do it the way he's called us to do it, we're going to get his results.
Yes.
I don't remember if it was Moody or if it was Charles Finney, but one of them said, those people who sit around and complain about their powerlessness in God, it's all their fault because they're never willing to go to the prayer room. Powerlessness with God is not God's fault. A lack of power, a lack of authority, it's not God's fault. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm just telling you, that's just the fire of God. When you're hungry, when there's things been going on in your life where you're seeking God and you're making adjustments, you cannot withstand what I'm saying. It's a fire. It'll explode on the side of your heart. It's just the way it is. You don't have to feel bad about yourself. You do need to feel bad about yourself. But let it be the turning of your heart and your passion. Say, okay, you know what? I'm going to go ahead and get this. Because God's going to respect your person. Huh? Then there's need to be 1, 2, 3 people being hit by the fire of God when the presence and the anointing of God is here to hit everybody with the same glory and have the same results and same outworking. Hallelujah. And you're going. Huh? You have to get in the press. Huh? You're gonna have to. You know what? You begin to interface with leadership and you find out whose will you're doing. You begin to interface with the man of God. Hallelujah. I loved one story I heard that Hyde, because I read his biography today. I'm going to refer to it a couple times. One story he said today, he said, I was with a preacher. He was so cold and his church so dead. He said that I got home and I started praying for my, I started saying, Lord, that so-and-so, he called him by name, that cold. And suddenly he felt a finger come upon his lips and he said, you're touching the apple of my eye. He began to cry and repent before God that he was an accuser of the brethren. He describes how his life changed. Keep a watch on my lip and the door of my mouth. Come, I'll teach you to fear the Lord. Watch your mouth. Understand how to recognize the things of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Understand the things that heaven has instituted, because a lot of people want heaven to be instituted in their life, but they don't recognize it around them. It's time for you to begin to understand people after the Spirit instead of after the flesh. Know yourself after the Spirit. Understand that God's got a big government going on right now. Hallelujah. All you got to do is recognize it and everything will begin to change. All you got to do is agree with God and everything will begin to change. Hallelujah. It's so easy to get into this program, people. It's so easy. If you don't have it, you're trying real hard not to have it. There's something going on really out of whack in our lives when we don't have something that God commands. Think about it. And it don't take too much of fasting and praying and get alone with God, hear all the nonsense going on in your head, huh? And begin to deal with things one by one. It says, okay, Father, bend me now. Huh? That's what Evan Roberts' prayer, September 28th. Okay, God, bend me now. I'm tired of doing it my own way and thinking of my own program. I want to be led by you. I want to come under your control and your rule. Ooh. And what happened to a man who had been praying for 11 years for revival? What happened to a man that had been praying for 11 years for revival? What happened to a nation? What happened to nations? Hallelujah. His prayer is right, and then he had to get his heart right. But prayer, get your heart right.
Yes, it will.
Get your attitude right, too. And the Lord's telling us how easy it is to get prayer, 11 and 8. He says, concerning the man who's banging on the door of his friend because he needs something. And so that's how he sets it up. He says, and though he will not rise and give him because he's his friend, he's going to get up because of his boldness. Because of his expectation, because he ain't leaving until he gets what he wants. Brother Yun's going to be here next month, March, what day? 20th. March 20th, Brother Yun's going to be here. And he told me, he said, you know how? He said, I'm going to tell you right now, this is how I stepped into the anointing with God. He says, when I was a little guy, I was a great beggar on the streets of Nanyang in the Henan province of China. And he said, what I would do is when they would tell me that they didn't want to give me any money, he said, I'd keep pulling on their jacket, keep my hand up there. If they knocked me down, I was right back there, hand up there. If they slapped me, I was right back there pulling on their jacket or whatever, my hand right up there till I got what I wanted. He said, I just brought that over into the kingdom of God. I just brought that over into the kingdom of God. You got to hear me? I just brought that over into the kingdom. That's what Jesus say right here. That's what he say right here. Hallelujah. Because I know God's not a liar. He's going to fulfill everything that he's promised. Huh? And as I cry out to him and as I petition him, what's going to happen is I'm going to find out what's hindering, what's standing in the way. I'm not going to discover that God has delayed. I'm not going to discover that God has changed his mind. I'm not going to discover that he's redefined the covenant in the program. I'm going to discover the things that I've not had right in my spirit, in my heart, my attitudes. And if I'm willing to let that be corrected, everything changes. And now all of a sudden, I understand how to receive the supply that's flowing from heaven on a continual basis. Hallelujah. Harabakai. I mean, we're right now seeing great miracles and signs and wonders. We've had wonder miracles right here. Even the people who can testify about tonight. We had great miracles take place here Sunday night.
Yes.
But there's going to come a time where we're going to press in to where that everybody's going to get a miracle. We're going to see every miracle. We're going to see the dad's got to listen to us. The dad's got to listen to us on a regular basis. Because Father will just agree with us. John chapter 14, verse 13, look at this. Whatever you ask in my name, whatever you ask in my name. Try to get around that. Whatever you ask in my name, I will do it. What? Who do we need to interpret that? If that's not happened, the problem's not with heaven, it's with you and me. It's a compromised life. And all we got to do is get in the presence of the Lord, get still before him, and he's going to show us what's going on.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Father wants to do it because that's how the Son's going to be glorified. I want Jesus Christ to be glorified. Look, people right now are in darkness and blindness of heart and mind. The reality of heaven has not shaken this generation as it has in former times. That's my fault. You can say it's your fault too if you want, but it's my fault. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to rise up.
Yes,
I'm going to do whatever it takes.
Yes.
If ever I've loved him, if ever I love him, I love him now. If ever I've been consecrated and committed to his will and his purpose, it is now. If ever I've been willing to be offered on the altar of sacrifice, it is now. Where are you at? What have you been sowing into? Because whatever you've been sowing to is what you're going to be reaping. Right now, I'm reaping. I'm reaping right now. Oh, God, to do thy will. Oh, God, to do thy will. Father, I so want to move in a greater expression of you and a greater authority with you. You've ordained me to bring forth this kind of fruit. He's ordained you to bring forth this kind of fruit. I'm going to show you. Verse 14, he says, "You shall, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it." I mean, you talk about just doubling up. And you think about what this is on the heels of. This is on the heels of anyone who believes these works shall you do and greater works than this. That's what that's on the heels of. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
And I could go to preaching that verses 10 through 14 right now. And I mean, it's just going to take me all night because it's this powerful message that you and I need to hear over and over again until we conform, until we straighten up and begin to understand that what God said was very exact And it's a demand. He wants it to happen. And the only reason it is not is because there's areas of our life where we're not willing to conform. Well, really be transfigured in.
And that's going to change.
Yes.
You know why?
Yes.
Have you ever heard me pray?
Yes.
I know I don't look very respectable when I pray. And I know that this would not be a nice tape to put on TBN or anything else, because I know what I look like. I know I look like a wild man when I get like this. You know what? But it ain't about the movies.
Yeah, it is.
It isn't about acting. It's about somebody who's going to keep it real. Huh? Somebody who's going to go after God, and it ain't about any other reason than doing His will. You've been called, people. You've been chosen. The Lord says in John 15:5, He says, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you'll ask whatever you will, and it'll be done. And what did He say? Next verse. Herein is my Father glorified. You want to be glorified. Oh, well, here's how it is going to happen. And guess what? Be glorified. We just might act like it's, oh, God, there's something you got to do. And, you know, we'll be around if you need us. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
You know our address. You got our phone number. Oh, God, you know how to get in touch with me. That ain't the way it works. It's a sold out, consecrated life. I'm not my own. I belong to Him. I no longer live. It's Christ Jesus that lives. It's got to be that. We don't want to make it that. And then we want to make it God's problem. Hello. Let's get this scripture in context. These scriptures are in that context to you and I having a sold out life to Jesus Christ, which is the only kind of life that makes heaven in the first place. I don't know or have any assurance for any other type of lifestyle of making heaven. Not from the Word of God, you don't. Not from the Word of God, you don't. No, in the severity of God, Paul said, we thus persuade men, for if one died for all, then all are dead, that we should no longer live unto ourselves, but unto Him who died for us and rose again.
Yes.
And for me, this is a shout of prayer. It's not just a sermon that I'm preaching or the Word of God that I'm declaring. And that's powerful enough, because the Word of God will change you when it's God's Word. It's a passion in my soul. Listen to me. This is not just a passion in my soul for you. This is a passion in my soul for me. A lot of times when I'm ministering on the things that I feel like, you know, that I'm seated in, there's a full working of it in my life, I'm just kind of really a whole lot more mild about it. But when there's things, it's intense for me, because I've got to lay hold on it. I've got to have it. I don't know how to even deliver it any other way. And now you understand this. I mean, this is what God's calling. This is what God's saying. This is what His Word. This is His. You got a problem with this? You got a problem with Him. You got a problem with His Word. And just one of the reasons that I'm just doing my very best to slow down, let's just let people see the verses of Scripture rather than just quote them. So people can stare at it a little bit longer. You let the Word of God have His way in you. Father's doing something big.
Amen.
Father's doing something big.
Amen.
It's happening right now.
Yes.
Father's doing something big. Everybody knows it. Everybody who knows anything in God knows something big going down.
Yeah.
I'm telling you right now, call them up. Anybody you can think of, if you have access to somebody doing something in the kingdom right now, ask them, is God doing something big right now? They're going to go, God's doing something really big right now. Who told you?
Who told you?
Good, something big's happening. Something big's happening.
Yeah, amen.
And I'm not going to be left out.
Me neither.
Something big's happening in the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Huh? I'm not going to sit around and watch everybody else flow and function in heaven while I'm standing on the sidelines.
No.
I know the difference between the holy place and the holies of holies. I understand it. And I'm certainly not in the outer court. And I'm not going to be out there either, nor in the court of the Gentiles, nor looking from a distance, nor longing to see what's going on over there when the bound is set and I can't cross it. Come on, people. Come on, people. Hallelujah. Does your life preach? Does your life preach I mean, all day long is it a sermon? Does it preach of that which God, the gospel that Jesus Christ delivered to us? It's the life that I now live in the flesh. I live by the faith of the Son of God. It's Christ who lives and not I. Come on now. Where is the consecration? Where is the dedication? No more hesitation. Verse 16. You have not chosen me. I mean, you talk about taking the burden off of you in that sense. This is my idea. You didn't choose me. I chose you. Look at here. Verse 16, chapter 15. And I ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever you ask the Father in my name, he will give it to you.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
What nation are you naming? I'm saying Father God, 40 yes. million past tunes. I'm saying Kashmir yes. Valley. I'm saying Satan, you can have it no longer.
Amen.
With your threats and your lies, Amen. Your scare tactics, yes. it keeps everybody out of there.
Amen.
They're going to give me a visa.
Amen.
What are you naming? His ministry, his inheritance, the uttermost parts of the earth for his possession.
Yes.
There's only one ministry and there's only one inheritance.
Yes. That's right.
You're going to have to be so passionate unto death to have it.
Amen.
It's got to be so important to you that you no longer live. It's got to be so important to you that you abhor your will. It's got to be so important to you that you hate your life in this world. It's got to be so important to you that you cannot give me these things or I die. John Hyde's prayer. Give me these, pray two prayers consistently. Give me these things. Give me these souls lest I die. And oh God, let me burn out instead of rust out. Pretty radical, huh? People start thinking, oh my goodness, if I live that hard and that intense for God, I'll die early. I'm going to hang on in my life. I'm going to go little by little. You don't give God little by little. It's all or nothing. It really is an all or nothing. The good news is his mercy and his long suffering will plead with us and 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 plead with us. He will call, he will beg, he will beseech, he will plead. Because that's the name of the Holy Ghost, the pleader, the one who pleads. Parakalein, which is the primary root of parakalitos, which is the name for the Holy Ghost that we translate comforter or helper. Parakalein means to plead. He pleads. He's pleading with me. He's pleading with me. He's saying, Mark, I want to use you. See, Mark, I see your heart, your willingness to go, but I need a little bit more participation here. I need a little bit more surrender here. I need a little more cooperation here. When I tell you to get up in the middle of the night, I want you to quit laying there. No more. I laid there last night. I'm gonna tell you right now, God so visited me. I'm not laying there anymore. Trying to go back to sleep because I'm taking care of my own sleep time. Because somebody said I need to sleep more, I was going to die. I am worn out. I am pretty stressed. And I get double eyebrows when I get really tired. And you ever know it, I get these red things over here at the top of my eyes. So you got to rest. You have to rest. You got to. And then you start thinking that. Huh? The Lord says, I said you're just supposed to get up. Who you got to go with? From now on, I'm telling you right now, I'm going to get up. When the master calls, I'm going to come every time now. I'm going to quit making it circumstance and happenstance and just can't sleep tonight. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
God's in the midst of you. He who is mighty is in the midst of thee. Recognize him. Agree with him. Start participating with him more. God who is mighty is in the midst of you. Christ is walking in your life. God, the Holy Ghost is there, right there, right now. You're alive in the Holy Ghost. Now you're supposed to start moving with him. There's a spirit of knowledge that can speak to the rock and water will come out. That can speak to the sun and the moon and stand still. That can say to the axe head float. To the oil and the flour do not diminish. And it must obey. The Lord will say to you, the word which proceeds out of my mouth shall not return unto me void, but shall accomplish those things which I send it to accomplish. And then he'll change it. The word, my word which proceeds out of your mouth shall not return unto me void. Oh yeah. Oh yeah, because now your words become his words. You're just speaking his word. You're not speaking your own word anymore. You don't spin your own opinion anymore. You're not opinionated anymore. You process everything through the word of God. Hallelujah. You don't process things through denominationalism, doctrines, ideas of men, philosophies. It's about the word. Ho sapata. Ho dasitaya. Asamonkideya. Come on. Come on. Come on. Just go ahead, shout a little louder for Japan. No, no. I'm talking to her. You shout a little louder for Japan. You just shout. I understand what's going on over here. I understand. I see when people respond to the anointing. I see what causes them to respond to the anointing. I'm watching you. But I'm going to tell you something. Father's watching you. Some people are moved because man's watching them. Or some people don't even care because man's watching. Whatever. Father's watching. Your words express your heart. Your behavior express your heart. Your response especially expresses that which you're able to participate with the Holy Ghost in. Hallelujah. John 16, 23. And in that day you shall ask me nothing. Here he goes. You got this? Listen to this. With absolute certainty, I tell you that whatever you shall ask the Father in my name, he will give it to you. Now, how many times have we got to be told the same thing before we get it? Huh? This isn't just two or three verses of Scripture. Come on. We've already gotten six of these repetitions. Let's get a seventh. Hereunto have you asked nothing in my name. Ask! And you shall receive that your joy may be full. Come on, I'm looking for some fullness of joy. That's why it says to people, you won't be half as sad as you are right now if you start giving yourself over to the things of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Ha! Rabba. You can be a nobody in the most remote part of the earth. And down on your knees, you can make the you can decide the outcome of nations. When you learn how to take hold of God, when you learn how to flow in the Spirit, when you learn how to let the intercession of Christ and the intercession of the Holy Ghost begin to move through you. That's not putting your little CD on, your little lights, your little incense. That's another gospel and another doctrine, and it has nothing to do with God's Holy Ghost inspiration. Just go shut yourself in a closet, Jesus said. Just go in there and turn a CD on. Hire a band, come play some sweet music for you. Drive off the devil so you can pray. I'm getting after it here tonight. I'm going to lay it out. Because ain't nobody ever moved in revival had all that stuff. Ain't nobody ever moved in revival and touched the nations and touched the hearts of men who did it man's way. They did it Christ Jesus' way. They did it God's way. All the fluffing stuff. All the pomp and circumstance. Oh, I need a crowd of people to get excited about the Lord. Hallelujah. Woo! We getting after it, man. We just knocking it right, left and center, amen. I came with the sword of the Spirit tonight. Hallelujah. Cut stuff up, bust things up, got the hammer. Hallelujah. Bust the rocks into, got the fire, burning up the chaff. Amen. Hallelujah. False ideas, philosophies of men. Another way in. We have access by the Holy Ghost. That's it. You don't have to learn how to respond. The Holy Ghost is going to change everything about you. He's going to make you a lot better, a lot nicer, a lot happier, a lot prettier, a lot smarter than you are right now.
Amen.
Getting filled with His goodness and His glory every morning. You're not going to live on day-old bread. You're going to come and mositaya. Ha! You're not going to live on yesterday's prayer. Say, Masitaya. You're not going to live on yesterday's intercession. Nakabosta. You're not going to live on yesterday's communion. Namasitaya. You in love. It's a fresh love. It's a romantic love. Hallelujah. Harasata. It's an exciting love. It's a run down my beloved. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Woohoo. That's right, that's right. Let the power of God just ditch you. I love seeing among you say, just different people getting touched by the different dimensions of where their heart's at, crying out to God. That's where Papa's going to meet you. Where's your heart at? Where are you crying out to God? Where do you want to meet him? That's where he'll come. That's where he'll come with floods of glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So to the Spirit. Recognize that every prayer moment, every prayer minute, every prayer hour is a sowing into the things of the greatness of God. Hallelujah. Every interaction with the Holy Spirit makes you that much more sensitive to Him. Every demand that you placed in heaven, everyone's heard. Hallelujah. The prayer of the saints is so special to the Lord, they're like they're eternal and put in censers, and it's as it were offered up before Him. My prayers are precious and sacred to the Father. I remember one day I was in a situation. And I had reason not to go to my hour of prayer. There was justifiable reason, but there was need. But I said, "No, I'm going." And the Lord visited me and said, "You don't know how blessed I am to have you here." I realized that many things are pulling on you, but you put me first. Changed my life. I was waiting for you here. He's waiting for you there to develop within your life a great anointing. He's waiting for you there to develop within your life His power and authority. He's waiting for you there to develop in your life His faith, His expectation, His love. Love is a doorway into all of His fullness. To know the love of Christ which passes knowledge and thereby be filled with all of His fullness. To know the love of God which passes knowledge. Hallelujah. To know the love of Christ. He that dwells in love dwells in God. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. For as He is, so are we in this world. The connectivity of love with His life, the love of the fullness of the expression of Father. Formed, shaped there. It's what Papa said to you, Christmas. Hey? Come on, I say, go after it, son. Go after it. Respond to the Holy Ghost. Go. Go after these things. You got a great prayer partner. Hallelujah. Go after these. Don't worry about the finances. Don't worry about the other stuff. It's fine. Don't worry about it. Seek Him. Do His stuff. He'll take care of your stuff. Hallelujah. Mike, we're going to miss you. We're going to send Mike. He's a human resource for training at the Mission Training Center. I've already got your spot picked out in the Kashmir Valley, believe me. Just because I see you're willing to go all the way, man. You're willing to do things other people wouldn't do. Father's not looking for anything other than a yielded, willing heart. And you're so yielded, and you're so willing, and you're so submitted. Father can look at you right in the eye and not see anything that's out of sorts. So you just get ready. All those things, those expectations you have, just remember why men ought to always pray not to faint. Huh? Just remember why He's going to get up and get you stuff. He's your friend, but He's not going to get up for that reason. He's going to get up because of your boldness. Father puts a high price on Holy Ghost boldness. He despises and hates arrogance and pride. But He puts a high price on boldness. People don't understand how to have boldness in the midst of meekness. It's just God's way. And these things don't just belong to one. They belong to all. They belong to everyone. Hallelujah. Acts 1:14. Everybody knows that the fun is in Acts. I don't know why preachers just don't preach on the book of Acts. I learned a long time ago, if you preach on the Holy Ghost, you're going to have a move of the Holy Ghost. You preach on healing, you're going to have healing. Huh? So why not just preach on the fullness of God as it's revealed in the book of Acts and just have the fullness of God as revealed in the book of Acts? I need you praying. We need you praying. Well, I need people praying. I need people persistent. Look, Kashmir is a fortified wall of demonic power against the gospel. They sing the song, "Oh, Mother, Mother Kashmir, oh, fountain of all knowledge." I'm telling you right now, it has been a fortified wall. Huh? It's the great pilgrimage of the Hindus and of the Buddhists. And huh? It's every demon power, once they lay claim to it. And God, Satan has set up such fear tactics that God's people don't even want to go near it because you're going to die. All we need is a bunch of people who know how to be nobodies and get down on their knees and begin to pray for even from the remote parts of the earth. Somebody said, "I live out in the country. What can I do?" You can get down on your knees and you can learn how to interact with what's going on in heaven and get yourself a translation, hallelujah, into the realm of glory and begin to speak Father's heavenly language, huh? Speak the language of heaven. Begin to speak out those things that will change the course of nature, that will subdue nations. We're going after, if you don't know your assignment or not, I know some people are still just kind of looking around wondering what they're supposed to do. Well, you have an assignment right now to take the nation of Kashmir through prayer. Yeah. And you don't even have to go. I'm going to go. All you got to do is risk your time. And I'll risk my life. Hallelujah. There's 40 million Pashtuns that have never been touched by the power of God. They believe that they Ephraimites, the descendants of Ephraim. They were exiled in 760 B.C. And they've kept their family name. They're the Al-Qaeda fighters. Because Ephraimites were always fighters. They need to hear the gospel of Jesus. There's a great harvest among the Pashtuns. There's a great harvest among the Orthodox Hindus there. The radical Hindu priests that are up there in those mountains. That their witchcraft is literally holding sway over the minds of a billion plus people. We're gonna go kill them with the gospel.
Yes. That's right.
Preach Jesus so that they can die. Hallelujah. Come out of those mountains with a shining, radiant face, with their kind of consecration and commitment to Hindu gods, and you take that and you put that kind of consecration and commitment to Christ Jesus, they'll blow the world up with the gospel. They'll blow the world. They're like Apostle Paul's all over the place, completely consecrated to everything about what they believe. Can you imagine one of those radical Hindus priests comes to the United States of America and begins to preach and declare the demonic powers that have entered into the church through yoga and through all the other things that belong to that demonic realm that he was once a part of, and he can spot it. He can spot it a mile away, so to speak. Huh? Because he's overthrown those demons, as it were. Can you imagine? Woo! Huh? There's so much stuff going on, so much heresy and lies going on in the church right now. We've got to have a great move. We're going to have one, too.
Yes.
Something big's up.
Yes. Amen.
Something big's up. Amen. We want you to go ahead and begin to wrestle with God at the Brook Jabbok.
Amen.
We want you to begin to cry out. Let the God, the living God, who really exists, who is God, let him answer by fire. Why don't you begin to come out, cry out? Huh? Acts 1:14, these all continued one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with all the brethren. Acts 2:42, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and the breaking of bread and in prayers. Come on, people, let's have it. Let's have Acts 2:42. Come on, let's have it. It's a determination of your will. It's all of a sudden you making heaven more important than earth. Jesus more important than you. I mean, these are just the basic decisions. We're going to have to bring it down to the radical, real decisions that really are being made instead of playing pretend. We're going to have to get so real. We need to confront the things that God has commanded of us. It's one of the things I love about fasting and prayer. Because all of a sudden, when the food shut off, and you're really fasting and praying, you're not fasting and sleeping or fasting and working, you're fasting and praying. I'm going to tell you right now, it will come to a point where you have to then, you know, if it isn't immediate, it will soon come to a point where you have to confront all these things. And you can either self-justify or you can fall down on your knees and say, bend me, Lord. You can fall down on your knees and say, I conform. Okay, Lord, no more. I surrender all. I'd love to preach tonight on the beauty and the glory and the splendor of prayer and its transfiguration. But I'm going to tell you right now, there's a bigger thing God's calling you to tonight. Humanism wants to always be drawn into how it benefits me and how it makes me feel good and how it makes me feel better about myself. And that is so integrated. It's so become part of people's language, the way they speak and the way they think, that the gospel of Jesus Christ and taking up his cross and denying ourselves almost has lost any meaning. People don't even know how to define worldliness anymore. They're so compromised. Oh, we're going to get in here, man. We're going to get over here and behold his glory and no longer live in relativism, but suddenly being captivated by the holies of holies and his holiness. Suddenly there will be a distinct difference between the world and him. And this is what we're praying for. This is what we believe in God for, this confrontation with God. This encounter with the Almighty. So that we can go now and present him to a world around us. And suddenly they have an encounter. When they encounter us, they encounter the living God. How you like that?
Yeah, I like it.
Hallelujah. Hi, Melson. I'm so blessed to see what happened to Alejandra. Is that right? Alejandro, the Lord really touched you the other night, didn't he? So wonderful, huh? Changed life. From darkness to light. Hallelujah. From lost to living. From dead to living. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's a whole world around us. There's millions of people right now that need to encounter the anointing of the Holy Ghost. They need to encounter the power of God. Father's looking for some people who will give their lives over to coming apart and being alone with him so such an encounter can take place. Acts 6:4, the apostle said, but we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. How the church responded to every event is captured in Acts 12:5. Peter, therefore, was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church and of God for him. There's a prevailing wind of prayer and a prevailing wind of the Spirit. That God, the Holy Ghost, is going to form in you. So that you may begin to take up with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Watching thereunto with thanksgiving. And you can't undervalue that watching thereunto with thanksgiving. Jesus said, couldn't you watch with me for 1 hour? He's saying it right now. I hear Christ Jesus saying from heaven right now, will you watch with me for 1 hour? And he's talking to us about an everyday watch, a willingness to come into his presence and begin to receive what he wants to supply right out of the realms of heaven for the need right now and for the things that Father wants to do in the earth right now that you and I cannot participate with unless we are willing to come and watch with him for 1 hour. Unless we're willing to engage in what he's given. And what he's asked us to respond to. Jesus. I feel tonight that just about everybody in here, just about everybody in this place here tonight saying yes.
Yes. It's
just about everybody in here saying yes.
Yes.
I'm telling you right now. Listen, Father, what I'm describing to you is going to result in that which you can't even begin to imagine right now, because you're responding with your heart, and that's okay, because that's where it's supposed to happen. You're supposed to be responding with your heart. Now you follow through, and what you can't even begin to think or ask is going to begin to take place through your life. These are the days of the great movings of the Spirit of the Lord. These are the days right now. These are the days of great change, of great opportunity. Hallelujah. These are the days, like in former days, in old time, when you read about the great sweeping revivals of where men stepped in to out of nowhere, stepped into the great manifestation of the power of God. I'm talking about people that were living in remote places that nobody knew, and suddenly the anointing came upon them and great glory began to be expressed through them, and the power of revival and the moving of the Spirit began to shape and change the world around them. These are those days right now. This is happening right now. These are those days right now. These are the days of the moving of God. These are the days of the sovereign moving of God. And He's looking for somebody, some people, somewhere to begin to cooperate with them, to come apart into a solitary place with them. To come up with them into a place alone with Him. Begin to pray. Begin to let the Word of God form within you the thinking of the Spirit, the mind of Christ, which will power within your life. Faith, great faith, mountain-moving faith. Expectation, God's going to do it. Love, God's kind of love that accesses all the realms of heaven. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Namasatikina. Namasatikashingala. Morisatia. Molasatistavi. Molistaferasita. Mungina Shipaya. Lamambrasai. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Marastate. Molastavritish. Mungina Shipaya. The wisdom of the Spirit. The wisdom of the Spirit. Mongoshivriti. Hallelujah. I want everybody, please, would you just stand with me? Torumasanda de Bekishti. Hala Masipatali. Oh, Satinini. If there's anybody in this place tonight, you don't know Christ Jesus. You don't know the power of His name and the power of His working to anyone who will call upon His name. At this very moment, everything about your life can change. If you're watching me by web, if you're watching me by YouTube, if you're here in this place, all you have to do is call upon the name of Jesus. All heaven responds to the name of Jesus. All hell moves out of the way at the very declaration of the name of Jesus. You call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be delivered by the power of God. Heaven will invade your life, and hell will be evacuated out.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And worse than that, it will flee in terror. Hallelujah. But I like to say evacuated tonight, because those that don't want to leave, God will usher them away. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. The power of the name of Jesus that will change everything about your life. If you live in sorrow and torment, the power of the name of Jesus will change it. If you live in some kind of sin and addiction, the power of the name of Jesus will change it. If you live in some kind of oppression, I don't care where you're at on the face of the earth tonight, the power of the name of Jesus will change it. You call upon the name of Christ Jesus, and you've got the promise of the Father, the eternal God, that everything is going to change. They that call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved, delivered, set free. God has vested all power and authority in that name, the name of Jesus. Every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. He's highly exalted the name of Jesus, far above all principality and power and might and dominion, everything that is named in this world and also in the world to come. And you can begin to take up that name tonight. Those of you that are standing in this place, maybe you've never come to realize how powerful the name of Jesus is. Maybe somehow the name of Jesus has been defeated upon your lips. But tonight, everything will change if you'll begin to take a hold of this faith that is given to us by the Holy Ghost. Everything will change when faith rises by the Holy Spirit and the name of Jesus Christ is mentioned.